Hello viewers, this is again your primary or preventive healthcare advocate, Bernard Abunushi. You can also call me Bernajis. I am the founder and the director of the health organization Bernajis Preventive Health Education. I'm also the author of the public-friendly medical book titled The Role of Public Medical Knowledge in Disease Prevention and Treatment. I am a nurse clinician and I work in one of the teaching hospitals in Ghana. Well, I bring to you for discussion a new disease topic. In recent past, we have looked at some major disease topics like diabetes, hypertension, kidney disease or kidney failure, sickle cell disease, cellulitis, that is a type of skin infection. The video presentations on these disease topics are on my YouTube channel, and I encourage you to go there to watch my presentations on these topics at Bernajis Primary Healthcare Media on my YouTube channel. I also encourage you to support my efforts by just clicking on the subscription button on my YouTube channel. You can also follow me on Facebook at Bernajis Primary Healthcare Media and watch the video presentations over there. Share the videos if you like them. Invite your friends and loved ones to join us. Learn together how to maintain good health. Our new topic for discussion is hernia. Yes, hernia. But before we get to that, I will always use the opportunity to reiterate that my presentations on various disease topics online are not meant for healthcare professionals only. They are not designed for students in the healthcare field only. My presentations online on various health problems or issues are meant for the general public. They are meant for you, a non-healthcare professional. My presentations on various health problems or topics, disease topics, are not meant to equip you, the general public, are not meant to equip you, a non-healthcare professional, to begin treating diseases at home. That is not the main purpose for my presentations. I have said it somewhere that treatment of disease is one of the complex aspects of healthcare delivery. And that is why the professionals in the healthcare field have to school for many years, doctors as much as 6-7 years. So the purpose is not to equip you to begin treating yourself at home, which is wrong and dangerous. This is the main purpose for my presentations online, to help the general public, to help you as a non-healthcare professional to at least have basic knowledge on disease topics or health-related topics. Yes, you are not a doctor, you are not a student in the healthcare field, you are not a policy maker in the healthcare field, but you really need basic knowledge on health-related topics or issues because you have a very important role to play to achieve better healthcare. You see, when a person comes to the hospital, when you go to a health facility, we have treatment goals for various health problems. We have treatment plans or goals. These are some of the treatment goals or plans. To stabilize a patient, if a patient comes to the hospital, one of the goals is to stabilize the patient. Another one is to cure the disease if it is curable. Another treatment goal is to manage properly the disease. Another one too is to prevent death, because many of the diseases can sadly cause the life of the patient. The last but not the least is to prevent complications of diseases. These are some of the treatment goals when you go to a health facility. These two treatment goals: to manage properly diseases and to prevent disease complications, hinge mainly on you, the general public, or you, the non-healthcare professionals. To properly manage a disease and to prevent complications of diseases hinge more on you, the general public, than the doctor or the healthcare facility. Just take a look at this. If a person is having a chronic disease, let me say diabetes or hypertension, he or she cannot continue to stay in the hospital for the management, the proper management of these diseases by the healthcare professionals. You cannot continue to remain on admission so that nurses or doctors will continue to manage your diabetes. The management of some of these chronic diseases is continuous. The management, the proper management, must continue in your house. The proper management must continue at your workplace, anywhere that you find yourself. The management must continue. So it means that you, a non-healthcare professional having this disease, or the loved one of the patient, must take charge in the proper management of some of these chronic diseases, The question then is, how do you properly manage these diseases if you don't have proper knowledge on the management? How can a diabetic patient properly manage diabetes at home, at work, to avoid disaster if he or she doesn't have proper basic knowledge on the management of diabetes? How can you manage properly the diabetes in your mother, in your aged mother or father or sister or uncle, if you do not have proper knowledge on the management? And this is one of the reasons why a lot of people do not properly manage some of these diseases, and they end up in a hospital in a very bad state. So it's easy to see a person with diabetes coming to the hospital with diabetic coma because the patient has no proper knowledge on how to manage the disease. Those around him or her do not have proper knowledge on how to manage the disease. So they easily end up having serious problems associated with improper management of the disease. So this is why we all need proper basic knowledge on health, so that you wouldn't have to be a doctor or a nurse to be concerned or to wish to have knowledge on health related topics. Another one is, if a person is having hypertension, you cannot continue to stay in the hospital for your BP to be controlled. You have to do that at home, wherever you find yourself. It's a chronic disease which requires continuous management. So you, a non-healthcare professional who is having this disease, you, the loved one of the patient who are not healthcare professional, must continue to properly manage or control the BP. So how can you control the BP properly if you do not have proper knowledge on the management or what hypertension is all about? Yes, this is the question. So again, you easily find people who are hypertensive come to the hospital with stroke. Yes, stroke is a disease that can be prevented. Once you have hypertension, make sure you control it. If you fail to properly control your BP, it is easy for the person to develop stroke. And the sad side of it is that when you go to our hospitals, our healthcare facilities, a lot of people are there because of complications of minor illnesses. people are suffering on admission bed in our hospitals in Ghana because they did not properly manage simple diseases. They did not properly take care of simple diseases at the initial stage. So they end up having complicated stage of the disease. So you go to hospital and then you find a doctor or a nurse very unhappy. You ask yourself, why should the healthcare professional be unhappy because you came to the hospital with a kind of sickness? Well, the doctor or the nurse saw that that stage of your disease, another disease can develop as a result of complication if you don't manage a particular disease well. So stroke is a different disease that can happen as a result of not properly managing hypertension. So the doctor or the nurse can become unhappy because he or she knows you are the one responsible for that serious state of your disease. Yes, he or she knows. So the person would then ask you, why didn't you go to the hospital when it started? Why didn't you go for treatment? Why didn't you manage the disease properly? So these are some of the reasons that will make the healthcare professional unhappy, because that bad state of your disease could easily be prevented. These are some of them. Now, the main topic. What is hernia? Well, anytime hernia is mentioned, I know a lot of people consider men. Many people believe that hernia is a disease for men, just as a lot of people assume breast cancer is a disease for women. But before we get done with the discussion, you realize that hernia is not a disease for only men. Yes, it is true. Men suffer hernia more than women. And breast cancer, which you'll be talking about, be discussing it later, we will realize that it is not a disease for only women. I had worked in the theater before as a scrub nurse, and I had been involved in the operation on ladies with hernia, women with hernia. I had been involved in the operation of men with breast cancer. So hernia is not a disease for only men, and breast cancer, it is not a disease for only women. Another interesting thing about hernia is that many of the local folks, the herbalists in Ghana here, most of them always advertise drugs. They say they have drugs that one can take to melt hernia. That is a serious statement to make, that you can take drug to melt hernia. But if you really know what hernia is, excuse me to say, it's ridiculous for someone to tell you, I have ABCD drug to take to melt hernia. So what is hernia? Well, hernia is when an organ pushes through an opening or a weakened spot in the muscle or tissues that hold it in place. Hernia occurs when any organ pushes through a weakened spot or an opening in a muscle or tissue that holds it in place. For example, we have the intestine as an organ, and then the abdomen as a large flap of muscles and tissues that hold the digestive system, the organs of the digestive system in place. So when the intestine breaks through a weakened spot in the abdominal wall, weakened spot of the abdominal wall, and then dislodge from its usual place to a new place, within the abdominal wall, then we can say hernia has occurred. That is, what is abdomen or where is the abdomen? Well, I can describe the abdomen as the region between your chest and hip. The region between your chest and hip in front of you is termed the abdomen. Many people refer to the abdomen, that is, that whole region in front of you or in front of us, as stomach. But the abdomen is a large flap of muscles or tissue in front of us that holds the organs of the digestive system in place. So you can refer to the whole of that region as stomach. Stomach is just one of the organs of the digestive system that the abdomen is holding in place. It's easy to hear someone saying, "My stomach is paining me." It's easy to hear a patient say, "My stomach is paining me," or "I'm having stomach pain." Well, it is more appropriate to say, "I'm experiencing abdominal pain," or "I'm having pain in the abdomen," rather than saying, "My stomach is paining me," or "I'm having pain in my stomach," because the pain that you are talking about might not even be coming from the stomach. There are other organs where the pain can be coming from, and not necessarily from the stomach. So it is more appropriate when you go to the hospital next time, just tell the healthcare professional that you are having abdominal pain. That is more professional and better than saying stomach. The abdomen, as I said, is what is holding the organs of the digestive system in place in front of us. So when we have a situation where the organ of the digestive system, maybe the intestine, pushing through a weakened spot in the walls of the abdomen and getting trapped there, or relocating, moving from its usual position to a new position within the walls of the abdomen, then we have hernia. Yes, that is what we term hernia. So as I said, the region between your chest and then the hip. So your groin form part of the abdomen, and then the hernia can occur there too. Wasi, omishi, wayome is part of the abdomen, and the hernia can occur there. The next area of the topic, types of hernia. We have different types of hernia based on certain factors. One of them is the location where the hernia occurs, giving it its name. The abdomen has different regions or areas where the hernia can occur. So these are some of the types of hernia that we have based on the location on the abdomen. We have epigastric hernia. We have umbilical hernia. We also have inguinal hernia. We have femoral hernia. We also have incisional hernia. We have other types, but these are some of them. The epigastric hernia occurs around the epigastric region, that is the area just below your ribs in front of you. The stomach is located there at the epigastric region on the left side of the upper abdomen. That is where the stomach is located, and hernia can occur there. And then we also have the umbilical hernia. Umbilical hernia is the protrusion or the bulging at the belly button or the navel. We often see this type of hernia, umbilical hernia, in children, where the belly button or navel bulges out. That is a type of hernia. When you see that in children or babies, it is a type of hernia. You also have the inguinal hernia. The inguinal hernia occurs at the groin. This is the commonest type of hernia, and it occurs mostly in men. I believe this is the reason why many people see hernia as a problem, a health problem for men, because inguinal hernia mostly occurs in men. This is the reason why it mostly occurs in men. You see, around the groin, there is a canal called inguinal canal. It is through this canal or route that the testicles descend just after birth. The testicles of a newborn descend through this inguinal canal just after birth. And the canal is expected to close almost completely behind shortly. But in certain situations, the canal doesn't close perfectly or properly, leaving an opening or a weakened spot where the hernia can occur easily in later life. So the intestine pushes through, forming a large lump in the area of the groin. Many people consider that large lump in that area as enlarged scrotum, but it is not really scrotum. It is not scrotum at all. It is part of the intestine that has moved from its normal position into the muscles or tissues in the area of the groin. In the vulvar region, or they always refer to that type of hernia in men as edovu. In the local dialect, this is how they call it, edovu, which means the person has developed extra scrotum, but it is not scrotum at all. It is part of the intestine that has dislocated into a wrong position in the area of the groin. Another type of hernia which I mentioned is the femoral hernia. The femoral hernia occurs between the area between the upper thigh and then the groin region. Yes, the femoral hernia occurs between the femur, the area between the femur and then the groin. Hernia can also occur there. The intestine can move from its usual location through a weakened spot to dislodge there, causing or forming the hernia. Another type that I mentioned also is the incisional hernia. This type of hernia can occur at any area where surgery has been carried out. When surgery is done on the abdomen, maybe laparotomy, the abdomen is open if it is not properly closed, if the muscles and tissues there are not properly closed by the surgeon, or the wound that developed is not properly healed, it can later result in hernia. Hernia can also be classified as reducible or irreducible. So what is reducible hernia? For now, we all know that hernia is an organ, internal organ, for example, the intestine, moving from its usual location or position into a wrong location or position within the abdomen, in a space within the abdomen. That is what we call hernia. So we say a hernia is irreducible. Hernia can also be classified as reducible or irreducible. So what is reducible hernia? For now, we all know that hernia is simply an organ, internal organ, for example, the intestine, moving from its normal or usual location or position into a wrong space or location within the abdomen. That is hernia. So we say hernia is reducible if the dislodged organ, the intestine, is able to return to its usual or normal location or position. Then we say that hernia is reducible. Reducible hernia is when the dislodged organ, the intestine, can get back to its usual location or position on its own or with a push by the patient or the individual himself, then we say that hernia is reducible. Reducible hernia may give no issue or problem to an individual. Reducible hernia resolves on its own intermittently. For instance, if the individual is standing or a pressure is exerted at the area or side, the hernia then shows or it bulges out. Or if the person is relaxing or sitting down or lying down, the hernia resolves or it is no longer there. That is reducible hernia. It may give no issue at all to the individual. Reducible hernia. We have two types of irreducible hernia. They are strangulated hernia and non-strangulated hernia. What is strangulated hernia, or when do we say hernia is strangulated? Strangulated hernia occurs when the entrapped organ, for example, intestine, in the wrong space or new location within the abdomen has blood supply cut to it because of constriction of the blood vessels that supply blood to that part of the intestine that got entrapped within the wrong space within the abdomen. Then we say strangulated hernia has occurred. I will take it again. Strangulated hernia is when the intestine, an organ, gets entrapped within a space, a wrong space within the abdomen, and it has blood supply to it cut off because of constriction of the blood vessel that's run to that part of the intestine trapped. Strangulated hernia is a serious surgical emergency that must be treated or corrected immediately. We all know that the blood contains food nutrients, oxygen that the body cells and tissues need to function properly or to survive. So if blood supply to the entrapped part of the intestine is cut off continuously, the cells and tissues there will begin to die off. Yes, the cells or tissues there will begin to die off, and it must be corrected immediately. If not, it could be fatal to the patient or the individual. On the other hand, with non-strangulated hernia, the entrapped intestine in the wrong space has blood supply to it. There is blood supply to the entrapped part of the intestine in the wrong space of the abdomen. There is blood supply to it. So that is the difference between the strangulated hernia and then the non-strangulated hernia. With the strangulated hernia, blood supply to the entrapped part of the intestine is completely cut off. So the cells there will begin to die off. The tissue there will begin to die off because they are deprived of food, nutrients, and oxygen to function or to survive. But with a non-strangulated hernia, from the word strangulated, there is blood supply to that part of the entrapped intestine in the wrong space of the abdomen. And the similarity between the two, the strangulated hernia and the non-strangulated hernia, is that both of them have a part of the intestine trapped within the wrong space of the abdomen and cannot return to the normal location or position on their own or with a push by the individual or patient. Let's look at another area of the topic: causes of hernia. Do we even have causes of hernia, do we have factors that directly cause hernia? Looking at what it is, we don't have direct factors or causes of this health problem, but you only have risk factors. You only have certain factors that make it easier for a person to suffer this health problem. These are some of the risk factors of hernia. We have aging. Yes, people who are older easily suffer from hernia because of weakness in the muscles and tissues of the body. Another risk factor is strenuous activity or lifting of heavy objects. A person who always lifts heavy objects or engaging some kind of strenuous activity that puts a lot of pressure on the lower abdominal muscle or on the muscles of the abdomen can easily suffer hernia in later life. Another risk factor is pregnancy. Yes, pregnant women are also at risk of developing hernia because of the heavy pressure the fetus, the developing fetus, exerts on the abdomen, especially the lower abdomen. So they can also be at risk of developing hernia. Another risk factor too is excessive straining during bowel movement. So people who suffer constipation and they have to strain so much in order to pass through are also at risk of developing hernia. Another risk factor is obesity. People who are obese, people who are overweight, they are also more at risk of developing hernia. Let's get to another area of the topic, treatment of hernia. This is the simple fact. Surgical procedure is the only treatment option for hernia. Hernia can only be treated through surgery. There is no other medical intervention for treating hernia. Based on all that we have learned about this disease topic or health problem, you should be able to agree to this simple medical fact that hernia can only be treated through surgery. If you look at hernia as simply the intestine moving from its normal position or location within the abdomen and then getting into a cavity within the muscles or tissues of the abdomen where it can be trapped and it will not be able to get back to its usual position, it can get back to its position or it may not be able to get back to its position, then we should all be able to agree to this medical fact that hernia can only be treated through surgery. The general term for treating all forms of hernia is hernia repair. Yes, the general term is hernia repair, and that term repair is understandable. Hernia surgery is basically the surgeon cutting through the site of the herniation, where the hernia or where the hernia occurred, and then getting access to the location or the cavity within the muscles or tissues of the abdomen where the intestine got entrapped, and then freeing it from that site back into its usual position, and then finally suturing or sealing off the point of entry where it pushed through to get entrapped within the abdomen. That is basically about the surgery, the surgical intervention for treating hernia. So referring to the treatment as hernia repair is appropriate. I'm stressing on this because over here in Ghana, it is very interesting, very often, to hear most of these herbal drug dealers advertise or present certain herbal drugs that you can use them to treat hernia. If you really understand what hernia is based on what I have said, just said, it should be very funny, excuse me to say ridiculous, for someone to tell you that there is a drug that you can take to treat hernia. The question is, what is the drug going to do? Is the drug going to remove the entrapped intestine within the walls of the abdomen and then seal the place? Think about this. So I do hear a lot of people, a lot of these herbal healers sell drugs to people. When you sit in commercial vehicles, they are there advertising seriously some of these drugs to people to buy. Unfortunately, you get people buying some of these drugs. And the question is, on the side of the seller, the one selling the drug to treat hernia, is it because he or she is completely ignorant about what hernia is? Is it because he or she has basically no knowledge about what hernia really is? Or he or she is just interested in making some money to the point of advertising drugs to treat hernia? And another unfortunate fact is that you see people buying these drugs, and they also clearly, I can say, is because of ignorance. It's complete ignorance for even to listen to someone who tells you there is a particular drug that you can take to treat hernia. And this is normally what they say when they are advertising these drugs. They say it in a local dialect. Ufa edru wea ebema o hernia no anani benani. And when you translate it into English, he or she is saying, when you take this drug, it is going to melt your hernia. Is going to cause the hernia to vanish. It will melt it. So the question again is, what is the drug melting? Is it the intestine that it is melting? It is basically the intestine getting entrapped within a wrong space or cavity, which must be freed. You can't melt the intestine. You can't do that to treat hernia. So this is the misinformation, this is the wrong understanding many people have on hernia, and they resort to wrong means of taking care of it. I will say again, this is an additional proof that we all need basic medical knowledge. This is an additional proof, because if you have basic knowledge on some of these things, some of these topics, you know what hernia is, it should be funny to you to hear someone tells you, buy this ABCD drug to melt off hernia. That should be funny and ridiculous to you. But because many people do not have basic knowledge on some of these health problems, they easily buy into such wrong marketing or such kind of wrong treatment options for many diseases. So I will again encourage you, you are not a doctor, you are not a nurse, you are not a health professional, but you still need to be conscious about health. You still need to have interest in health related topics or issues in order to avoid some of these problems. So those of you who are young, please advise your aunties, your grandmothers, your older family members that hernia cannot be treated with any other drug. Hernia can only be treated through surgery so that they wouldn't have to be taking these herbal concoctions without going to the hospital and later find themselves in serious health problems, other serious health problems like kidney disease. This is the main reason why you should know what hernia really is. That is when to seek treatment. I have mentioned different types of hernia: reducible hernia, irreducible hernia, and the types of irreducible hernia. Among all the types, it is only strangulated hernia, which is medical emergency, which must be treated immediately to avoid deadly situation. It is strangulated hernia that will prompt an individual to quickly seek treatment because it comes with serious immediate health problems like pain, serious pain. It can even cause the life of the individual if it is not treated early. That is why we target emergency. So the problem is that many people have hernia and then they ignore it. For example, someone who is having reducible hernia may not cause any immediate problem, health problem to the patient or the individual. The person can ignore it. For instance, if the hernia comes and then resolve, if the person stands up and then the hernia shows, the person sits down and then is no more showing, that is, the hernia is able to resolve on its own intermittently, which is the reducible hernia, it's easy for someone to ignore it. If someone is having a non-strangulated hernia, which is a type of the irreducible hernia, it is easy for the person to ignore it because with that one, the person may not feel pain, the person may not have any immediate health problem to quickly prompt him or her. The only thing is that a person might not be comfortable with the herniation or the protrusion at the site where it occurred. That is the only discomfort the person may feel, but the person might not feel pain, which will force him or her to go to the hospital. That is the problem of hernia. And I had been saying in Ghana here, many people do not look towards the hospital for treatment unless they are in serious health crisis or unless they are in health crisis. They only look towards the hospital when they are in crisis, serious health problem, when they are having serious health problem. So if you have this type of hernia and then you don't treat it because it is not giving you any immediate health problem, such type of hernia, the reducible hernia, can result in the strangulated hernia, which requires emergency treatment. The irreducible hernia, which is non-strangulated, can convert to a strangulated hernia, which requires what? Emergency treatment. So if you don't want to find yourself in a situation of dealing with emergency treatment of hernia, then make sure you take care of your other types of hernia. If it is reducible hernia, make sure you take care of it, even though it is not giving you any form of pain. Make sure you go to the hospital to treat it. If you have non-strangulated hernia, protrusion on the abdomen to your groin level, and it's not even giving you pain, I am encouraging you to go and treat it because there is a chance that it can change into strangulated hernia. Something can occur and then there can be a cut of blood supply to that part of the entrapped intestine. And once that happens, it's going to cause serious health crisis, or it's going to cause health crisis, and it must be treated immediately. If it is not done, it can even cause the life of the patient or the individual. So you don't need to find yourself in that kind of situation. If you have your mother, if you have your father with that type of hernia, just arrange, just go to the hospital and take care of it as selective surgery, where you can plan with your surgeon or your medical team for it to be taken care of, rather than waiting, where you will not have any option but to treat it under emergency care. Now let's look at the last area of the topic, prevention of hernia. Can hernia be prevented? Well, looking at what hernia is, I would say hernia cannot be prevented completely. There are no specific measures one can take to completely prevent hernia or block the occurrence of this health problem, which means that everyone is at risk of developing hernia. Anybody at all can develop hernia. I will use this opportunity to reiterate that hernia is not a health problem for only men. Hernia can occur in women, or hernia does occur in females, women. It is not a problem for only men, though it occurs more in men than women. But it is a health problem for all, both males and females. I made mention of some risk factors of hernia. So if we can do something about those risk factors, then we can reduce also our risk or our chances of developing a hernia. What are some of the risk factors that we learned earlier on? I mentioned lifting of heavy objects. So if you are known for lifting heavy objects, please put a stop to it, so that you will not find yourself developing hernia in the nearest future. Another risk factor is straining when passing stool. So I will encourage you to take in enough food so that you will not have to be experiencing constipation where you have to strain yourself so much when in the washroom. Another risk factor I mentioned was obesity. So control your weight so as to reduce your risk of developing a hernia. Viewers, this is the end of my presentation on the disease topic, hernia. I hope you have learned something. I encourage you to continue watching my presentations on various disease topics. The video presentations are on my Facebook page at Bernajis Primary Healthcare Media. If you like the presentations, I encourage you to share with your loved ones and friends so that we can all learn together to maintain good health. Visit my YouTube channel, also at Bernajis Primary Healthcare Media, and watch the video presentations there. If you have not yet subscribed to my YouTube channel, I encourage you to do so. Just click on the subscription button to support my efforts. I want you to always remember this. One of the greatest assets one could ever have is good health. And you must do everything to guard and to protect your good health. Watch out for another presentation on a disease topic.